हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हेलो स्टार्टेड अगेन दिस पार्ट बी। Students, this is the part B of the lecture. Those who will be watching it later in offline. So we have all. This is some. I think network issues. There, something is not going well, students. Students, I'll do one thing. Those students who are in the live session right now, I'll record for you this lecture and I'll put it across, okay? Something, I'll just do it. Maybe I'll record it and then I'll put it and I'll share the link with all of you. So that is one thing. Now it has come. Let's see how much time it is there with us. So students, let's see. Hopefully the things subside now. Section 46, students. Section 46. Now, those who are watching this lecture, capital gains, I have a brief part I have taken for 5-7 minutes. That was a part A before this flip flop happened and the content went out. I was talking about this part, students. This is something, although it is very detailed out, but you never know. This is, I consider this section to be a final CA section. That is about what? That is about, students, the liquidation of the company. Students, let you continue. You guys continue with your studies. Primarily, I'll just record it once the system is back. Maybe even if it happens tonight, I'll just see when it comes back. You guys study, and maybe I'll just put it in your group, your live lecture. If somebody is awakened at night, I'll take the lecture that time. Okay, let's see. We'll just try it out. So I'll just take the lecture now at night, maybe whenever it comes out. I'll just put it in your WhatsApp group. Those who are thinking, sir, which WhatsApp group you are talking about it. So again, I'm giving you the contact number, students. You can just contact it once for being added to the WhatsApp group, which has been made. 9594554391 9594554391. You can just message here and tell them to add you in the income tax inter-CA revision WhatsApp group. So they will do the needful, and if the things get sorted out, maybe in some time or maybe even a bit later also, I'll record this lecture and I'll just put it across in the group itself. Okay, fine, students. So you guys study. And anything like bit of chit chatting I can do with all of you. What are the areas, students, you can let me know primarily, since it is not there. A bit of 5 minutes chit chatting, also we can do it in the meantime. Nishank is asking, sir, section 46 was not done in regular class as well, and if you feel it is not important, you can skip. Anyone students, I inter CA, I'm not talking about any final CA students, inter CA students, have you done 46 in your regular lecture class, this section 46? My only concern is this, that since they have given, I'll at least will let you know, students, there is one flow chart. If you see in this page 3.383, in your, don't see this thing is, maybe a bit chit chat here and there, you never know, Ashwini. So see this particular thing. So what to say now, this is like, it is just trying to test our patience. So suddenly it is like blinking and all, and just trying to test our patience. Anyway, so 46, I think nobody of you have done it. So since ICA has made so much of an effort, and also knowing the fact that they also may be knowing that you have not done it at all, even the ICA would be aware then. So my thought is this, that when they may ask you this particular 46 thing in your MCQ. So let me give you a brief outline of this chart at least. Students, I'll give you a brief outline, hopefully with all the prayers now, at least this 46 gets negotiated, then maybe we can just do it. Students, all of you quickly, very quickly, even though this chart will not be there then with me, please, if you have your module in front of you, where in this page 383 you can have it, because this may go out, you never know. So I just don't want to take a chance on this. Okay, so you have your module ready. So 383. So if something this goes out, at least we can finish it off the liquidation of the company on the capital gains front. This chart is what I just wanted to do with you, students. Okay, but however, I should say to you that there is something of the deemed dividend angle also of section 222, which is there in your next topic. In the IFOs topic, students, I'm going to do only two things. You'll say, sir, what are the two things you are going to do in IFOs? One is the deemed dividend, and second is the gift tax. So these are the two things which I'm going to touch upon. So deemed dividend and gift tax is what I'm going to do in IFOs. One section of deemed dividend, 222C, has got an impact in this section. One particular part of deemed dividend, 222C, has got an impact in this section. So you'll say, sir, what exactly it is? Let me then come to the section first of all. Now, students, when the liquidation of a company happens, when the liquidation of the company happens, then what actually takes place is this. There is a transfer which takes place from both the parties. There is transfer which takes place from both the parties. You'll say, sir, which are those two parties? So party number one is the shareholder. Party number two is the company itself, which is going under the liquidation. There is a transfer which is taking place from both the parties. Party number one is the shareholder, and party number two is the company. Now you'll say, so what kind of transfer has taken place? Now, I being a shareholder, my final transfer is that of the shares. I being the shareholder, my final transfer is that of the shares. That's it. Tata, bye bye, goodbye to the company, isn't it? And for the company, the final transfer that they are doing is the asset that they are transferring. For the company, the final transfer that they are doing is the asset that they are transferring to the shareholder. Isn't it? So, what I am doing, my final transfer, students, my final transfer is a transfer of the shares. The last transaction which I'll do with this company, that's it. And the company does the last transaction with me. They give me what? They will give me the asset. So if you see over here, students, there is a section 46.1. There is a section 46.1, students. 46.1. So what is this section 46.1? You will say, sir, why you are laughing, by the way. I'll just say to you, students, one thing. The screen right now has got stuck primarily. Means I can rotate in my this thing, but this is not moving. Anyway, but at least the best part that has happened is that our relevant thing is there in the screen, so that at least I can complete this topic or section with all of you. So God has listened to the prayer. So 46.1, students, is about what? 46.1 is about If you see very carefully what they have written on the left hand side, students, in the hands of the company, in the hands of the company, section 46(1). Now, if you can write next to that, if you all have the chart, that module with you, if you can just write next to that, this is an exemption. Students, this is what? It is an exemption. Exemption of capital gains in the hands of the company. Just next to 46(1), students, you have to write. Next to 46(1), you have to write. What are you going to write? Exemption of the capital gains in the hands of the company. Exemption of the capital gains in the hands of the company. Meaning thereby, when the company, students, when the company transfers the asset, primarily, to whom? To its shareholder. What point of time? At the time of its liquidation, no capital gains arises. No capital gains arises. Students, now please pay attention to this particular concept which I just wanted to draw upon. By virtue of this concept, you will learn a lot of things. What is that concept I want to teach you? Please pay attention. Students, when a person dies, and in consequence of his death, be careful. Please listen to this carefully. When a person dies, and in consequence of his death, there is a transfer of an asset that is taking place. There is a transfer of an asset which is taking place. Then, such transfer is not considered to be a taxable transfer. Such transfer is not considered to be a taxable transfer. This is what the concept is. You would say, then, how do you substantiate this particular point, sir? So, let me substantiate this one. Individual dies. Father dies. The asset goes to his son. At least you all have done this. In that case, whether this is considered to be a taxable transfer? And the answer is no. It is not considered as a taxable transfer. You have seen that. So, this is in the case of who is dying. The death is that of the individual. The death is that of the individual. Okay. Now, I go to point number two. And the point number two is in respect of HUF. Have you studied in section 47? In HUF also, they have written something about HUF. If you haven't studied, then you may flip the pages further and you will find that 47 also. And what is written over there? It is written that on the partition of the HUF, on the partition of the HUF, if there is a transfer of the asset by the HUF to its member, then that is not considered as a taxable transfer. That is not considered as a taxable transfer. So, no capital gains liability in the hands of the HUF. No capital gains liability in the hands of the HUF. Now, but it is in the hands of the partnership firm, students. In the hands of partnership firm, the only exception to this theory is the partnership firm. The only exception to this theory, students, is the partnership firm. And what is this exception? The exception is that on the dissolution of a firm, if the capital asset is distributed by the firm to its partner, then such transfer is considered as a taxable transfer, and the partnership firm is liable for the capital gains tax. Those who would have studied 45 subsection 4, they would have came across this point. If a firm distribute its capital asset to its partner if the firm distribute the capital asset to its partner, then irrespective of the reason why the firm is distributing the capital asset to its partner, whether the reason is the dissolution of the firm or the reason is, say, maybe one of the partner is retiring, whatever it be, if the firm distributes the capital asset to its partner, the capital gains will be chargeable in the hands of the firm. The capital gains will be chargeable in the hands of the firm. So, this is what the situation is. So, only exception, students, is the partnership firm. On the death of the partnership firm, which is in the form of a dissolution, if the firm distribute the capital asset to its partner, then such distribution will it be chargeable in the hands of the partnership firm? And the answer is yes. Okay, but what about the remaining persons? What about the remaining person? If they distribute the asset on their death to their legal heirs, to the members, to the shareholders, whether there would be a charge of the capital gains? And the answer is no. There is no charge of the capital gains. So, on the similar lines, if you see the company on its dissolution, sorry, the company on its liquidation when it distributes the asset to whom? To its partner. Sorry, to whom? To its shareholders. On that distribution, the company will not be liable for the capital gains tax. On that distribution, the company will not be liable for the capital gains tax. So just keep that particular point in mind, students. But can you see that blue color? In that case, there is a blue color line subject to the dividend distribution tax. All those who are appearing for November 20 attempt, for you, this is the last particular thing. After that, the dividend distribution tax. By the time you come to final CA, you will not even know what it's DDT. Fortunately or unfortunately, you just have referred DDT right now only one time. The actual DDT concept, you will not even learn it because the DDT concept is last now for November 20 attempt. From May 21, November 21 attempt, this DDT concept is taken out completely. So, what is this concept of dividend distribution tax? First of all, when a company, this is applicable, students, for a company. Which company? A domestic company. So, in respect of certain distribution by the domestic company, the distribution which is made by the domestic company to the shareholders, such distribution to the extent of the accumulated profit possessed by the company. Please repeat with me. The distribution made by the company to its shareholder to the what? To the extent of the accumulated profit, to the extent of the accumulated profit possessed by the company, that much of the portion, that much portion of the accumulated profit is considered as a deemed dividend. That much portion of the accumulated profit is considered as what? As a deemed dividend. Okay, so therefore, I'm just giving you an example, quick example, students. Please be careful. I am a company. I am going in liquidation. Okay, I have got an asset whose value is, say, 12 lakh rupees. And I am distributing that asset to the shareholder because I am already in liquidation, so the asset will be distributed to the shareholder. Now, the value, the fair market value of that asset is 12 lakh rupees. The fair market value of the asset is 12 lakh rupees, whereas the accumulated profit of the accumulated profit of the company at the time of liquidation is rupees 10 lakhs. The accumulated profit of the company at the time of liquidation is rupees 10 lakhs. So, your deemed dividend will get restricted up to rupees 10 lakhs. The deemed dividend will be restricted up to rupees what? 10 lakhs. Just now I told you, whatever is the value of the asset that you have distributed, but to the extent of the accumulated profit possessed by the company, that much portion is known as a deemed dividend. That much portion is known as a deemed dividend. Deemed dividend, students, under section 222C. Deemed dividend under section 222C, and then on that particular deemed dividend under section 222C, the DDT under section 1150, the DDT under section 1150 will be charged. The DDT under section 1150 shall be charged. Okay, Priya, I'm coming to that 10 lakhs. Just first of all, just first understand the concept here. So the company, although it is eligible for an exemption on capital gains front, the company, although it is eligible for exemption on the capital gains front, but is it liable for a deemed is it liable for the dividend distribution tax on the distribution that they have done? And the answer is yes. And the answer is yes. So students, can you see over here, subject to the dividend distribution tax? That is what they are trying to suggest. Fine. So again, I'm repeating, students, company will be exempt. So you can write therein, just for the sake of this thing, that the company will be exempt from the capital gains tax, but the company would be liable for the dividend distribution tax. Fine. Now, on the right-hand side, if you look into it, they are talking about for the shareholders. On the right-hand side, students, if you're looking into it, and they are talking about the shareholders. In the hands of the shareholders, students, there is section 46, subsection 2. In the hands of the shareholder, there is section 46, subsection 2. So here, what will happen for the shareholder? Section 46, subsection 2. As I told you just now, that the shareholder also is doing the final transfer. The shareholder is also doing the final transfer, isn't it? Because the shares is what is finally getting transferred. So there is a transfer both from the end from the company by distributing the asset, and there is a transfer also from the end of the shareholder by transferring the shares. As far as the company is concerned, on the transfer of the asset, there is a complete exemption that we have seen, exemption on the capital gains, but the company will suffer the dividend distribution tax on that particular value. What about on the shareholder then? For the shareholder, primarily, whatever is the asset value which they have received, whatever is the asset value that they have received, that value will be chargeable in their hands under the head capital gains. That value will be chargeable in their hands under the head capital gains in as a consideration for transfer of their shares, as a consideration for the transfer of the shares. But be careful on that value of the asset, students. On that value of the asset, a portion of the value is already considered as deemed dividend, is already considered as deemed dividend. And don't you think that on that value, already dividend distribution tax has been paid. Already dividend distribution tax has been paid. So if again the entire value is charged to tax, if again the entire value is charged to tax, then it will result into a double taxation. And that is the reason why, students, if you see on the right hand side, just see on the right hand side, students, on the right hand side, students, extreme right, what they have said, for the shareholder, money received means if any cash is received plus the fair market value of the asset distributed, fair market value of the asset distributed. Now from that fair market value of the asset distributed, some portion of the value of the asset, some portion of the value of the asset has already suffered the incidence of, has already suffered the incidence of dividend distribution tax. So again, if you want to charge that value in the hands of the shareholder, then that will result into double taxation. And that is the reason why, if you see minus deemed dividend under section 222C, minus deemed dividend under section 222C. And that exactly what the things has to be considered. So for the, what would be the full value of consideration for the shareholder? In my example, if you remember the example which I just gave it to all of you, how much was the fair market value of the asset? 12 lakhs. Whereas what was the fair market, what was the accumulated profit of the company? 10 lakhs. So the fair market value was 12 lakhs. Accumulated profit was rupees 10 lakhs. So how much was my deemed dividend? 10 lakhs. So I have received the asset value of 12 lakhs. I have received the asset value of 12 lakhs, but only to the extent of the accumulated profit, to the extent of the accumulated profit, which is rupees 10 lakhs, which is rupees 10 lakhs, that much of the value would be reduced. That much of the value would be reduced, and the net amount only, what is the net amount? 2 lakhs. 2 lakhs only would be considered as my full value of consideration. 2 lakhs only would be considered as my full value of consideration after reducing. Why I'm reducing 10 lakhs? 10 lakhs I'm reducing because if I take the entire 12 lakhs, then that will result into a double taxation. Then that will result into a double taxation to the extent of the value of rupees 10 lakhs. That will result into a double taxation to the extent of the value of rupees 10 lakhs. Why? Because to the extent of rupees 10 lakhs, the company has already paid dividend distribution tax. So if the same asset on which the portion of the value was already charged to dividend distribution tax, if on the same value, if I am being also charged for the capital gains tax, then that will result into a double taxation. Then that would be resulting into a double taxation. And that is the reason why my full value of consideration, while I am calculating my capital gains, being a shareholder at the time of liquidation, the value of the asset which I have received, from that value of the asset minus whatever was considered the deemed dividend under section 222C, on that value, that will be reduced, and the net amount only will be considered as full value of consideration. Net amount only would be considered as full value of consideration. And friends, you all are aware what would be the cost of acquisition. You all know the cost of acquisition, the shares value which I have acquired. The shares which I have acquired, that is my cost of acquisition, isn't it? So the shares which I have acquired, that is my cost of the shares, and accordingly I'll calculate my capital gains. My take, students, to all of you is this: you will be getting, students, herein, how much would be the deemed dividend of 222C? That is one question. And we all know the deemed dividend of section 222C will be up to the accumulated profit of the company. That can be one question. Second question, which is equally very much likely, would be what would be the full value of consideration in the hands of the shareholder? What would be the full value of consideration in the hands of the shareholder at the time of liquidation? Even this is very important question for your exam. So these are the two very important questions which I will say only in the form of an MCQ they are going to ask you. So at least, because they have made 2 pages for this, I thought at least discussing with you in this regard. Any query, students, that you will have, you can just let me know so I can explain. I'm not, there are a lot of things which are there in this case, but by the time you will reach to final CA, this section will have a lot of refinement because the DDT will not be there. But at least right now for a November 20, do this much. up to 10 lakhs, Priya is asking whether it will be exempt. In the hands of the shareholder, it is exempt because we all know there is an exemption which will see in IFOs. When I do with you IFOs, yes, that 10 lakhs exemption will be there. But that is for dividend exemption, Priya. Any query, students, on this one? So again, I'm repeating, students, the final net result is this. The company will not be charged to capital gains tax. I have already given you a general principle. The general principle is that a person, when he dies, and because of his death, when he distributes that asset to whom? To his legal heir, to the member, to the shareholder. Then in that case, the person who has died, on his hand, no capital gains will be charged. Of this principle, there is only one exception, and that exception is in the case of a partnership firm. A partnership firm which has distributed primarily in who has distributed the capital asset to whom? To the partner at the time of dissolution. Even in that case, the firm would be liable for capital gains tax. Fine. So the company will not be charged for the capital gains tax. Okay. But the company on the liquidation will be liable for DDT under section 222C. DDT under section 222C. So that is what it would be considered in this regard. So that is point number one. In the hands of the shareholder, 46.2 is going to come into play. And in the hands of the shareholder, 46.2 is going to be coming into play. The full value of consideration, students, 46.2, the full value of consideration under 46.2 would be whatever the amount that the shareholder is receiving from, whatever amount that the shareholder is receiving from the company, minus from that the deemed dividend under section 222C. Minus from that the deemed dividend under section 222C is what will be reduced. Okay, so why it will be reduced? I have already told you the logic. The logic happens to be to eliminate the double taxation. Fine, students. So this is one thing that we have covered up. Now, I think the chart, all of you have copied. Again, I'm repeating those who have just joined. Part A, a bit of it, I have done it earlier. This is actually a part B in this regard. Now, students, I'll just split for all of you 47 also, which is the section which we are supposed to do, but because of, obviously, I have to do it through the slide, and I now will close the session, so I'll just now put it across, but I'll do a segmenting. What is that you're supposed to do in 47? All of you will try to understand the logic, students, here. For your students, IPCC, you will divide 47 into three parts. You will divide 47 into three parts. So this would be very logical for you also to comprehend. Now, what is the three parts? First part is in respect of what? Like the thing which I've just now spoken about it. What was that? On account of the person's death, that the asset has been transferred. On account of the person's death, that the asset has been transferred. So that will cover your individual, that will cover the HUF, and also that will cover your company, which we have discussed just now. So that first part is a part for the death. And because of death, I have to give up the asset. So, will you tax me? Will you tax the dying king? And the answer is no. But the only one exception happens to be the partnership firm, for which I have already told you it is 45 subsection 4. Part 2. Students, part 2 of 47 would be about the business restructuring. It would be about what? About the business restructuring. And you'll find you'll have amalgamation and demerger. Do only the two things. Amalgamation and demerger. There are other things also, conversion of, maybe third, one more thing you will do, conversion of a company into LLP. There are total four. If I have to say to all of you, there are total four business restructuring that should be there. One is the amalgamation case. Second is the demerger case. Third one is about company to LLP. And the last one is about the firm to company. Firm to company. Now, when you do this four category, the company which is transferred to the other person can be the amalgamated company in the case of an amalgamation. The other person can be the resulting company in the case of a demerger. The other person can be the LLP in the case of the conversion of a private company into LLP. And the other person can be the company in the case of succession of a firm into a company. So in that case, in the hands of the transferor, who is the transferor? The transferor happens to be one in the amalgamation. The transferor was amalgamating company. In the case of demerger, it was a demerged company. In the case of the conversion of the private company into LLP, it was the private company. In the case of the succession of the firm into a company, the transferor was the firm. So in the hands of the transferor, on satisfaction of some condition, we have to see that some condition, no capital gains will be charged on the transfer of the capital asset in those business restructuring exercise. So there will not be any capital gains implication on fulfillment of some conditions. Okay, apart from that, students, there is also one more angle that you have to take into account, that like in the case of an amalgamation, like in the case of a demerger, at least these two, the shareholder, I was a shareholder, students, of the amalgamating company. Now what I have got, I happen to receive the shares of the amalgamated company. I happen to receive what? The shares of the amalgamated company, isn't it? So whether the shares of the this can also be argued. You can also argue that, sir, this is a transfer that you have done. Earlier you have the shares of X Limited, now you have shares of Y Limited. So it is a transfer that you have done. So will this be considered to be a transfer? And the answer is, students, no. It will also not be considered to be a transfer in the hands of the shareholder. But again, subject to satisfaction of some condition. So this is what, students, you are going to learn in part B, the second part of 47. So I'm dividing the 47 into three parts. This is what you have to do, 47. First part, the person who dies and in consequence of the death, there's a transfer. Three things you have to remember: individual, HUF and company. Partnership firm, exception, even on the death of the firm, but on account of dissolution, if they have transferring the capital asset to the partners, it will still be chargeable in the hands of the firm. It will still be chargeable in the hands of the firm. Fine. And the third and the last category of section 47, third and the last category of section 47 that you all have to do is about what? Is about the certain specific conversion of the financial assets. You'll say, sir, what is this conversion of the financial asset? I'll give you two examples. One, conversion of debentures into a company, into a shares. And second, conversion of a preference shares of that company into the equity shares of that company. Conversion of preference shares into the equity shares of the company. This is the third part of 47. So conversion of what? What is the third part, students? Conversion of the financial assets. What to what? First, debentures to equity of the same company. So I am having convertible debentures of Reliance. Now, because of that, that debentures got converted into the shares. So what will be the treatment? 47. It will be covered in section 47. Second part. I am having the preference shares, redeemable preference shares or convertible preference shares of Infosys. Now, subsequently, that preference shares got converted into an equity shares. So whether that conversion also would be covered under section 47? Again, the answer is yes. Even this is covered. And that is the three parts of section 47, students, that you will always touch upon. Fine. So this is what you will do. This is what we are going to do. And I have already discussed, because here, students, there are only like couple of issues that we have to discuss, like Manjula Shah and all. If you are aware of Manjula Shah judgment and all. So that is one thing which is being there. So my suggestion, students, yeah, reverse mortgage is also there. So reverse mortgage, I will just keep as a special concept. Reverse mortgage, which is one of the point which is there, I keep them as a special concept. But just keep 47 into three parts. Be very clear that when I have to revise, revise in this way. The way I have told you that first is the charging section. We have made the list. Second is 47. 47, three parts. The dying person transferring it. There will be a transfer that this will be not considered to be a taxable transfer, and therefore no capital gains will be chargeable in the hands of the transferor. And the example from individual, from HUF and from the company, three things only. Second part is a business restructuring. Four cases I have already identified: amalgamation, demerger, conversion of the private limited company into LLP, and the last one is a succession of the firm into a company. And the third one, which is about the conversion of the financial assets. Okay. And one last particular point you can say could be about that reverse mortgage. So this is your second part, and that's precisely how you're going to revise it. We are going to do it now very quickly because I have already set the base for all of you. And if possible, students, if you can just quickly go through the module questions and all, it will become very easy for me also to wrap it up, because this entire thing was about the structuring which I have done for you. The logic I have already given to you. Now we will quickly run through a couple of questions, and on that basis of the questions you will see we are in a position to wrap it up very fast. One assignment which I am giving it to you, students, based on the today's chart. What is that assignment which I am giving it to you based on the today's chart? Is about the last one. What is the last one? Slum sale. And the slum sale and the last, what was the next one? Slum sale and advance money forfeited. This is the easiest one. Slum sale and advance money forfeited, students. So please do ensure that you just do that part which I've made in the initial, the chart which I've prepared, so that we now stay focused about what we are supposed to do. We are supposed to do now quickly. Tomorrow I'll do the problems. There are certain practical problems, and then I'll switch to exemption. Even then, exemption, there are certain practical problems. Okay, and once that has been done, thereafter one more class I'll do for the tax rates which are being given to you, and depreciable assets here and there, and we should be good to see it through. In IFO, students, I have already told you, in IFO, what I'm going to do with you, the two things. One is the gift tax and another is the deemed dividend. Because these are the only two areas of the focus that you should have. Other than that, it's a simple thing. It's a miscellaneous stuff. Okay, and then we may switch to house property or salary or maybe any topic that you want me to touch upon first. And I'll just try to discuss on that particular front. So students, if possible, if you want to revise quickly that 47 now, on the basis of this three segmenting which I have done with all of you, please do that. Okay, so that you can now have the grip, and we will directly do in the next class the practical problems. Fine, students. Total income, yes, I will focus on that, Trinad. But I have doubt whether they will ask total income question. Like in PGPP, we have done some total income part. Let me then do some selected total income questions with all of you also. But they will not ask you that big questions and all. Because obviously, if you see your marks weightage with the split with IDT and also the MCQs, they may not ask you very lengthy question. What I think is that they will mix up two heads, not all the five heads together. That they cannot afford to do it. So in your IPCC, they will not, in intermediate, they will not merge all the five heads. Maximum, they can manipulate two heads. Two heads they can manipulate. Okay. At the most, they can go to three heads. But not beyond three heads. It can be salary. The combination can be like salary, house property, and maybe a capital gains. Salary, house property, or capital gains. That can be one of the combination, primarily. Another combination can be house property, capital gains, and maybe PGBP, some sort of 44AD they will give it to you. So that is how they will try to make up the combinations. So that is one thing which we will be doing. So let me touch upon some good questions, but don't expect with the limited number of 50 marks that you're playing around that you will get a full-fledged primary five heads income and then chapter 6A, tax liability and all those stuff. That will not be there. So three heads maximum, two heads or three heads tops. Chapter 6A reduction bit will be there, ATC, ATD, something like that, total income. That is the kind of a combination that they're going to put across. So that is what these people are going to do. Yeah, chapter 6A, that's what I said, chapter 6A. Yeah, Priya. So the total income which these people have given in the module, this kind of total income, now it was in our attempt when we used to get 100 marks paper. Income tax. Then it was a full-fledged five heads, chapter 6A total income. So I will do definitely total income. So what I will do, house property, I will do it also very fast. Because house property also, I think all of you are okay with it. You know the house property. So therefore, there is no such thing. So I'll quickly do some critical here and there quick revision on house property so that as you are suggesting me to come to total income first, I'll accordingly will try to expedite and come to the total income, and we can spend some 3 days or 3 sessions or 4 sessions maybe to do some good selected problems on the total income. Okay, so that is what we can just try to do it. So let's expedite on these heads. The biggest one, how PGBP is already done. Basic concept also we have done with it. Now capital gains we'll get through in the next 2-3 lectures. Then one class maybe would be for IFRS. One lecture then I will give it for house property, because I think house property should not go beyond one class. And then if you want me, we can directly go to total income. Or if you want some salary to be done, you can just identify. Salary is not difficult. Salary is only one thing which you have to by heart numbers. Salary as a topic, students, is a topic which you have to by heart the numbers and all. So that is the real problem. My suggestion, students, is salary in chapter 6. If you take my advice from me, salary and chapter 6 reduction, these are the only two areas wherein the numbers are present. You cannot do it one time and then do it. My suggestion, students, is this, that salary and chapter 6A, you should always go through daily basis 20 to 25 minutes. 20 to 25 minutes, students, you should always go through to salary and chapter 6A. What is the reason? Because of the limits, the threshold limits. In salary topic, students, you may be aware what is salary for the purpose of the gratuity calculation, what is salary for the purpose of leave encashment, what is salary for the purpose of HRA calculation. It keeps on differing, it keeps on changing. You are aware of that. So that is the reason why it is not a job of one time. You have to keep on like 15, 15, 20, 20 minutes from now, maybe tomorrow or so, till like for next 40 days. If you do 15, 20 minutes, salary requires only that much of time. Salary in chapter 6A. But you do daily, so it will keep on registering and you will then not make a mistake. This quick revision of this aside, 20, 20 minutes, if you do the revision, that is much beneficial for you to register these two things rather than at one slot you make it a go. No, at one slot you can do like CG, at one slot you can do like PGBP, because now we are fragmenting it. We are fragmenting it, and now you can visualize. Now you can visualize, but salary you cannot visualize. You have to actually see, and chapter 6 also you have to see, because it is all about numbers and all. You have to remember them, and that is the reason why, students, just keep this particular point in mind. And that is where you will be in a position to crack it. Did you all got this one? Yeah, that is what you use my chart. The charts are already there. I have already given the charts in a very comprehensive manner for salary also and for the chapter 6A. So just keep on going through. In fact, if you have already taken the print of the chart, you can just keep. In fact, I can tell you, final CA students, they put the chart in all the wallpaper and they never waste time. Like what they do is this, that I'll tell you. Like they will see the wall and maybe even 20 minutes they will have got, they will just see the wall, and at least by looking at it, they are revising some portion of their income tax syllabus, because the portion is very vast. So 15, 20 minutes, students, these are the magical things. And not for all the topics that you have to do this exercise, only for two topics, for income tax, salary and chapter 6A. That is all of it. After that, you don't have to, because rest of it is all about concepts. You don't have to by heart it. Did you got this one, students? So I'll do with the total income part. We will invest more time than in the total income question, provided you be ready for this particular couple of things which I have suggested with all of you. Tomorrow we'll do 47. We'll try to do the practical problem on 47, and then we switch to the exemption part. Okay, students? So this, please do this. What I'm suggesting you, it will, you'll remember me on the day of the examination. Your life will become so easy that you'll just remember me on the day of the examination, what I've said to you. And provided you implement it, what I'm saying, hardly it is will take you much of time. If you do it, you'll definitely will remember me on the day of the exam. Primarily, that your life is easier now as far as your tax papers is concerned. Fine. Because see, rest of it, PGP, I have already fragmented it. We have already fragmented it. It has become very manageable now. CG also have fragmented it. The biggest topic, I'm fragmenting it. And I'm making you understand it in a very logical sequence. But you cannot say, sir, gratuity 10 lakhs, why not 5 lakhs? Sir, that is what, like, we cannot have half of the half month salary, all that, primary 15 by 26, all these things, you just 100 rupees per month per child, maximum to two child and all. You have to do it. Are you getting this particular point? So there cannot be any kind of an argument. I cannot say no. In 1957, the finance minister has put across 100 rupees, 150 rupees. These things I cannot speak about it. So that is the real challenge of these particular thing. Tedious topic, we will do it as and when will come, Priya. Tedious topic, few sections are important. One big sections which are being there, 194H, 194C, 194I, 194J. So you focus on the core sections as far as the TDS is concerned. 194C, 194H, 194I, 194J. First cover up the core sections. And thereafter then maybe some like LIC premium and all. Then you can look upon to the remaining sections. But first the core section, and again there also we will do the compartment. Let me come to TDS. One lecture I'll do it and I'll wrap it up. Fine. Let's see you tomorrow, students. Same time, primary. And sorry for the inconvenience, but still we have been successful to fruitfully utilize the today's session. Okay, if possible, students, quickly go through this 47, the three split which I have already created for all of you. Death of the person. Second is the business restructuring, in which four cases: amalgamation, demerger, conversion of the company, private company into LLP, and fourth one is the succession of the firm into a company. And the third category is the conversion of the financial asset. Okay, conversion of the financial asset. First is the debentures to shares, equity shares, and second is the conversion of the preference shares into an equity shares. Fine, this is what you will do it, and I'll see you tomorrow. Okay, good night to all of you, students. Thank you very much, and do take care of yourself. I'll tell you one more thing, last point, students. Till 29th of September, you have to take care of yourself. Till 29th, the timings are not that good. Okay, you'll say, sir, what will happen on 30th September? 30th September, it is my birthday, so all the things will happen. Everything would be coming to normalcy, but only till 29th September. Please do take care of yourself. Okay, I'll see you then, students, tomorrow. See you then.